Ladies and gentlemen, and all the children.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Hooray!
There you go.
Catch hut! All right, let's open our services today and celebrate this wonderful day of Memorial Day in honor of all those that have fallen. And for our freedom, freedom is not free, we know that. Many have paid the price, the ultimate price, to give us the freedom we have today. The Lord Jesus said this, greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. It's my prayer, like Micah's prayer, and they shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up a sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. That should be our prayer today. Let's pray for all of the men and women around the world representing the United States in harm's way today, that they not have to pay the ultimate price. But if they do, let's pray for their families, that God would give them merciful grace. Pray with me. Our Father, we do rejoice today as Americans, Lord, understanding that we have freedom beyond so many other cultures. And Lord, we realize that freedom is not free. It costs the lives of millions and millions of people down through our history. But Lord, today we take a few moments in the year, we call it Memorial Day, so that we can remember those that have given the ultimate sacrifice. Lord, bless their families, bless their memories. May we always be a nation that honors them that have given so much to us. We ask in the name of the God of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and our Lord Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
I'd like to call up Girl Scout Troop 2395. Is that the wreath? Thank you, girls. I'd like to have a moment of silence for those veterans that didn't return, but paid the ultimate sacrifice. Now I'd like to call Reverend Bruce Page to the podium. I stand corrected. We have a bugler?
You do the taps, right?
Taps? Okay. Call Reverend Bruce Page.
Recognizing that too often we turn our neighbors on this planet into people we fear and resent, may we close this moment with a prayer that we may be worthy of the sacrifices that other people have made, keeping America a land of welcome and opportunity. Let us pray. Wondrous Holy One, rarely do we look for opportunities to die for our country, whether in battle, as a security force, or serving for diplomacy. But lives are cut short in moments of ultimate sacrifice, out of love and devotion. Today we have recalled people from our families, people whose stories we have learned, and people we have not known at all, who gave their lives for this country and its citizens. Help us to go on remembering them, putting them together whole in our hearts, holding them close as we go on living toward high purposes. And should our lives be put in peril on behalf of others, may we follow their noble examples. Bless them as we remember them. Amen.
Group dismissed. Mr. Supervisor, the parade is formed, American flags have been placed on veterans' graves, and we're prepared to conduct the Memorial Day ceremony.
Thank you, Mr. Marshal. Carry on.
Thank you, sir. I'd like to invite Reverend Bruce Page to the podium for the invocation.
Years ago, President Clinton signed the National Moment of Remembrance Act of Congress, calling for a moment of silence across the country at 3 p.m. every Memorial Day. Ask us later for the story behind that. Please pause now, of course, again at 3 p.m. for a silent moment before we pray together. Creator and Redeemer, revive now in our hearts and memories those legions of service people who have made ultimate sacrifices to protect our freedoms in a troubled world, thus offering us the gifts of peace and loving kindness. In our gratitude and in their blessed memory, may we make choices and pursue actions which, though difficult, are necessary for justice and healing in the world. Show us our children, show us our elders,
Remind us of the noble dead. Inspire us to live boldly for these loved ones and for all who remain vulnerable in this still troubled world. God have mercy. Amen.
At this point in the program, I'd like to thank President Clinton, Secretary Clinton, and Governor Cuomo for attending today. Round of applause. Making this special day across America even more special. I'd like to also recognize all veterans in the audience today. If you'd raise your hands. Thank you for your service. We can never thank you enough. I'd also like to ask all the parents right now to hug your children, if you will. I want to make a new tradition here. I've got friends, and a lot of us veterans have friends that can't hug their children because they didn't make it back, gave the ultimate sacrifice. So, parents, please take this moment to hug your children. I also want to thank Captain Jim McCauley, who's been the marshal of this parade for over 20 years. A big round of applause for Jim. His work has been amazing. He's a Green Beret, two tours in Vietnam. We can never thank Jim enough. He's an amazing American, and he's the dedication that he's had to make this parade so special for over 20 years is very amazing. I'd also like to recognize Gold Star mothers in the audience, as well as distinguished guests, and the Che family and Mrs. Che. And now I'd like to have the Pipers play Amazing Grace. Thank you, Carrie Pipers. And now I'd like to call upon the Horace Greeley High School Band to play America the Beautiful. Thank you. thank you to the Horace Greeley High School Band. I'd also like to give special recognition to Captain Michael Levine, 3rd Battalion, 4th Marine Division, 81st Mortar Platoon, who just got back from Syria. Welcome home, Captain Levine. Now I'd like to welcome Christine and Emma Grace up to the podium. And they're going to do something, one of the many things that makes our parade here in town so special. We're going to read some histories of Newcastle war veterans. In this case, it'll be World War II. So, Christine, take it away.
William Buscomi. Newcastle residents who have lived here for a long time may remember eating at the Twin Diner. It was owned by the Buscomi family. The building is no longer there, but it was located on South Greeley Avenue. The Buscomis had 8 sons. John, Jerry, Robert, Greg, Sal, Tony, Frank, and William. William Buscomi, or Willie as he was often called, was considered the most liked of all the brothers. His younger brother, Tony and Frank, remembered their brother as a courageous and gentle young man. He attended Pleasantville High School and he was a good student, but he had no time for sports after school. Instead, he worked at the family diner with the rest of his brothers. In 1943, while attending high school, William was drafted into the United States Army. He served in the 4th Armored Division in the 3rd Army, the 3rd Army Commander as General George S. Patton. After the extensive training in England, the 4th Armored Division had landed at Utah Beach on the Norway coast of France on July 11, 1944. A month after the D-Day invasion, within weeks after the growing resistance, the tanks of the 4th Armored were sweeping across France, driving the Axis forces back, all across the front Allied forces, pushing the retreating Germans toward their own borders. By late November 1944, Combat Commander A of the 4th Armored Division was advancing toward the city of Dijon, France. On November 30th, near the small village of Le Bear, Private William Buscomi's company and M. Forrest Shepherd tanks formed a column of German 88 hidden in the wooded countryside nearby. The German 88 cannons were feared by the most of their troops in power and accuracy. They proved very effective against the thin-skinned American tanks. Buscomi was driving the lead tank with the tank commander and 3 other men. The Germans 88s fired and hit his tank. Then the Germans targeted the last tank in the column. This effectively trapped all the tank between the two burning vehicles. They then began to raise havoc with the remainder of the column as the tank was destroyed. Buscomi was too badly wounded to get out of the damaged tank. At the young age of 19, Private William Buscomi died of his wounds near the town of Laubert. He was awarded the Purple Heart posthumously, which was received by his mother. After the war, his remains were inherited by the Mount Calvary Cemetery in Valhalla. A solemn requiemant mass was held at the Holy Innocents Church in Pleasantville for him. His name can be found on the Veteran Memorial in Newcastle and also on the memorial in Pleasantville.
Thank you, Christine. Emma Grace.
Peter J. Lynch. Peter Lynch was born on February 6, 1926 in Mount Kisco, New York. His parents, Patrick and Angus, were Irish immigrants that settled in New York City in 1908. Holidays for Peter must have been lively events because of his large family and the fact that his mother and her sisters had once formed a singing group that performed on stage. By the year 1930, his family moved to Chappaqua and his father got a position as a chauffeur for family in town. He lived with his parents and 3 sisters on Heights Cross Road, possibly in the home of his father's employer, Being Catholic, his family sent him to St. Mary's High School in Katona, where he graduated in 1944. Peter was known to be the quiet, contemplative type of by his peers. So it's not surprised that he envisioned himself as a priest in the future. However, those dreams had to be put on hold when he was drafted into the Army right after his graduation. In April of 1944, he arrived at Fort Dix, New Jersey to begin his basic training. After training, he was assigned to the 78th Infantry Division, 309th Regiment in Company L. He joined them in Camp Kilmer, New Jersey, a staging area for soldiers going overseas. He didn't wait long as the division boarded ships at Piermont, New York, and sailed for England. They arrived on October 26, 1944, and with little more training, they were ready for combat by the late November. The men got their first taste of combat by attacking the towns of Smithereth and Wittworth near the German border. When the Germans unleashed the offense that became known as the Battle of Bulge, the 78th Division was in the thick of it. Sergeant Lynch had his platoon in battle as the 78th Division sludged its way through town after town with little rest for himself or his men. On February 28th, they crossed the Ruhr River and they headed into the heart of Nazi Germany. On March 7th in 1945, the free world thrilled to the news of stunning victory. Shortly after 3 o'clock that afternoon, a small group of American infantrymen, engineers, and tank soldiers captured the Ludendorff Bridge at Remagen, New Germany, and were crossed the Rhine River. It was the front page news. From that victory sprang momentous consequences. Final defeat for Germany was brought weeks closer, and thousands of American and British lives were saved. General Eisenhower rushed troops across the bridge before the German counterattack. The 78th Division was one of the first divisions to cross and was tasked with expanding the bridgehead. The Germans threw everything they had at them, including V-2 rockets. On March 14th, Lynch's regiment was engaged in heavy fighting around the tiny German village of Honeth. The most stubborn opposition was met at an old stone quarry. The after-action report for his unit documents the battle. Men inched their way forward despite the mortar artillery, self-propelled gun, and automatic weapons fire. Then, with the artillery rolling its bridge in front of them, the riflemen raced across 400 yards of open ground in the face of direct fire from all types of enemy weapons, stormed the hill, and in hand-to-hand struggle gained their objective. Sergeant Peter J. Lynch was cut down while leading his men in his daring charge. He was 19 years old. He was awarded the Purple Heart posthumously. After the war, his remains were returned to his family. He is buried at the Gate of Heaven Cemetery in Mount Pleasant next to his mother and father.
Thank you, Emma Grace. Thank you, Christine. At this point in the program, we're going to read the honor roll for the town of Newcastle War Dead. World War I, Sante Filizola, Frederick Wallington. World War II, David Chittenden, Richard Cook, David Corrigan, James Corsi.
World War II, Ralph Ginsburg Jr., Gerard Held, Thomas Hill, Peter Lynch, Erwin Orser, Gustav Ruckert Jr., Robert Slater, William Viscomi, Max Weinberg, Andre Whalen, Edward White Jr.
Korean War, Charles Puget. Vietnam War, William Moss, Hugo Winterhalter Jr.
Operation Enduring Freedom, Staff Sergeant Hugh Young Shane.
This is Q's brother, Hugh.
At this point in the program, I'd like to introduce our keynote speaker for today, Captain Jonathan Lutwak. Captain Lutwak spent several years growing up in Israel and is fluent in Hebrew, came to the United States and attended the United States Military Academy at West Point. He graduated from West Point and was commissioned as a second lieutenant in the United States Army. He is airborne qualified and aerosol qualified. He was serving in Kuwait on the day of 9/11 and realized the next couple of years were going to be full of service for him. He's a combat veteran who served in Operation Desert Spring, Operation Iraqi Freedom, and Operation Enduring Freedom. He's a graduate of Columbia University's Business School with an MBA. He's had a successful career in real estate around the world with Cushman and Wakefield, and he now serves as CEO of his own firm, DHC Real Estate Services. He serves on the board of the West Point Society of New York as a vice president. He also serves on the board of the West Point Jewish Chapel. He is joined today by his wonderful wife, Barry, and his daughter, Zoe. He is also one of my closest friends, and I'm very proud to call him a friend, and I'd like to bring him up right now. Please give a round of applause for Captain Jonathan Lutwak.
Somebody has a dagger if I go over 30 minutes, so let's see if I can get this going. As I unlock technology and see if I can get our speech going, I just wanted to mention that I saw the governor right when this parade formed up and he heard I was speaking, and he said, "Do you have a joke?" And I said, "No, you got one?" And when he started with an American flag, a priest and a rabbi, I said, "Stop right there, we're good to go." So, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, fellow veterans, President and Secretary Clinton, Governor Cuomo. Before I start my remarks, I really want to thank all the hard-working men and women who put this parade and ceremony together. They are the unsung heroes that make it possible for all of us to be here and pay tribute. I want to particularly single out Jill Shapiro, wherever she is. An applause is due. Not only is she the town administrator who worked so hard to put all this together, but today is our 35th wedding anniversary. Thank you for being here and congratulations. A For many of us, many Americans, Memorial Day weekend is a time to look forward to. It kicks off the beginning of summer, our plans for vacation, camp for the kids. It's a time to enjoy a long weekend, to break out the grill and soak up some sun with family and friends. But today here we gather for a more somber reason, to remember, to pay tribute, and to honor the men and women who died while serving in our armed forces. The tradition behind Memorial Day dates back to the end of the Civil War, when in 1868, the head of an organization of Union veterans established a day for our nation to decorate the graves of soldiers that fell in the Civil War. Today, we continue that tradition and pause together to pay our respects to our fallen hero. We honor their sacrifice. We honor their selflessness, their patriotism, and the legacy of service they leave behind. Gettysburg, Antietam, Belle Wood, Normandy, Iwo Jima, Baghdad, Kabul, Kandahar. Here and abroad, Americans volunteered to fight for justice, for liberty, and for freedom. In a world seemingly dominated by a perpetual news cycle filled with cynicism, it is easy to get lost in the noise, to lose hope, and to forget just how special this country is. Even with all our problems, and we don't always get it right, there is still no nation on earth that has sacrificed more to rid the world of tyranny, to defend freedom, and to protect the innocent. Lincoln at Gettysburg said that we here are highly resolved that these dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from this earth. His words still ring true. While we don't always get it right, at the core of our nation is a sense of decency, of fairness, of kindness. That gentle spirit is the same found in our nation's soldiers, airmen, and Marines. Most people often think of the military as a place for warriors, of physical and mental toughness. And while the men and women of our military embody a fighting spirit, they are also kind, thoughtful, and decent. It is something anyone who has served knows firsthand. For me, it was witnessing some of my own soldiers donating what little money they had to help fund school books for Iraqi children, watching the care they showed when interacting with civilians, and the work they put into trying to rebuild infrastructure while we were there. Our nation's soldiers are warriors. They are patriots, but they are more than that. They are also fathers and mothers, sons and daughters, husbands and wives, sisters, brothers, aunts, uncles, and friends. And no one understands the burden of their sacrifice and the sense of loss that comes with it more viscerally than the families of the fallen. To all the Gold Star families here and everywhere, we honor you, we grieve with you, we remember you. All of us owe you a debt of gratitude that we can never repay. Franklin D. Roosevelt said that in the truest sense, freedom cannot be bestowed, it must be achieved. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm here to tell you that the men and women of our armed forces understand this. They are the 1%. They answer the call. They raise their hands and say, "Send me." As we gather here to honor that sacrifice, let us all honor their service by serving each other, by being kind to one another, by showing grit in the face of adversity, by coming together as an American family, by thanking not just our veterans, but also our educators, our firefighters, nurses, police, caretakers, and everyone who lives a life of service. When we come together and honor each other in this way, we earn the right to enjoy the freedoms bestowed upon us, each of us, by the sacrifice of our heroes. As you enjoy the rest of the day in this beautiful weather, and savor the camaraderie of friends and abundance, let us also remember and honor those who made it possible that are no longer here to enjoy those things with us. Thank you.
This time, I'd like to give the command to the 5th New York. Morn, arms. New York will now fire a volley.
Let him out! Hey! Bank ready! Present! Elevate! Fire! Let him out! Hey! Present! Arms!
Fifth New York, stand at ease.
Shoulder, your fire locks. Order, your fire locks. Take your peace.
Thank you. Appreciate that. Round of applause. I'd now like to ask Horace Greeley High School bugler to play taps. Parade. Attention. Present arms. Order, arms. Now I'd like to ask the Horace Greeley High School band for the playing. Please stand for the playing of our national anthem. Parade, attention! Present arms!
Order, arms. I'd now like to ask Rabbi Jonathan Jaffe to the podium for the benediction.
In the Jewish tradition, we respond to death and mourning and loss through gratitude. We give thanks for the time we have been given with our loved ones. Even in times of sadness, we respond by saying l'chaim, to life. We honor the fallen by confirming our commitment to peace and loving kindness. Today we turn to our friends, our neighbors, in the spirit of fraternity. Together we lift the spirits of the mourners among us and honor the fallen through our chesed, our deeds of loving kindness. Today may we emulate the courage of those who came before us, giving all they had to provide a better future for each and every one of us. V'aseh shalom b'mermav, v'aseh shalom, aleinu ve'al kol yoshvei tevel v'imru amen. May the source of peace and harmony throughout the universe bestow peace upon us and throughout all of humankind. And let us say, amen.
Thank you. Thank you, Rabbi Jaffe. As we wrap up here, I'd like to thank the Chappaqua and Millwood Fire Departments, the Chappaqua Ambulance Corps, the Chappaqua Police Department, and the Chappaqua Department of Public Works. I'd also like to thank again Captain Jim McCauley for making this such a special event for the last 20 years. Barbara Jankel, Lori Townsend, David Egerton, Michael Finkelstein, and Eric Rosenfeld, all for being a part of this special day for all of us. Can I have a round of applause? And of course, I want to say thanks to Joe Shapiro once again. And we have the Girl Scouts will now present the wreath. Thank you, girls. Round of applause for the Girl Scouts. Mr. Supervisor, request permission to dismiss the parade.
Permission granted.
Parade dismissed.